dogs, a drought's melting and rain. We put into the streets a flooding of hopeful beats. 400,000 strong, the swell of a rising sea. Together we march in the streets of New York. Mosaic of hope in the streets of New York. Stop and they know we are unstoppable, another world is possible, and we'll turn it around from the mountain to the shore. The ocean's acidic, rising and getting sick. Ooh. Hear our voices and those of a billion. Together we march in the streets of New York. Mosaic of hope in the streets of New York. An echo of fears from years of falling under fears. The momentum won't stop and they know.
I'm getting over a cold a little bit, so if there's some screeching, that would be why. So coming up next year, this year, in December 2015, does anybody know there's a big event happening? Paris. Who knows about COP21 or knows what that is? Yeah? Okay, we've got some informed people. Most people, when we go to a show or hang out with friends, we say, you know, we talk about COP21, they're like, oh, I don't know what you're talking about. And so that's why, partially why we wrote this album, was to educate people about the important decisions that are going to be made this December in Paris, and the impacts and influence of those decisions decades after Paris, which is why we named the album Decades After Paris. So this song is us imagining that we're sitting in a little Parisian cafe waiting for the events to unfold and thinking about the importance of the talks in Paris. And that's what we're singing about.
The song is called Paris Takes the Stage.
A ship on beers from Belgium, counting all the ways that we the math of Berkeley, borrowed from an ancient sea, counting all the footprints leading up to what will be. No time for second guessing. Reinvent prosperity. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. 137 years ago we gathered here. Scientific wonder, movement from thin air. Window to a future, lost to a familiar fate. The sun still shines upon us, and it's not too late. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. When the lines and lines on paper guide the titans to lay bare options for redemption, salvation may be in there. Breaking the last generation to make history, the first generation to feel the records. Breaking the last generation to make history. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. Paris takes the stage again. Not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end. Paris takes the stage again. It's not a show, my friends, a pathway or the end.
So this next song that we're going to play in the album, so Paris, the Paris Summit has happened, and now we're thinking like 5-10 years maybe in the future, and we're thinking about resource industry shifting and power shifting, where the money is going, and the struggles that are associated with that. This song is called Titans, and it kind of addresses the loss and pain of work and industry and how it's going to affect an individual person, like say somebody, like a family member working in the tar sands, and just people in general. But it sounds a bit more upbeat.
It's,
a bit more
it's happier than that.
Costly change was made in the name of a stable way. Meat cost the wage of a day. Droughts recessed down the seas at bay. Black golden age is gone. We're finding our way and we're moving on. Titans moving mountains. Whoa, honey, Titans moving mountains. And all the people say, tell me about a time when the light will shine, when the light will shine. Tell me about
a cloud when the light will shine, when the light will shine. Deep pockets got the fate of a blue dog with hot, hot danger. Tell me about a time when the light will shine.
My brother seen the world shift its way with a scowl and cry. A living mate and lost on the way down a long cut line. He's not the only one, no. Doctors, teachers, and all our children all felt the slow decay of a system that has lost its way.
Titans, moving mountains, whoa, honey, Titans, moving mountains. And all the people say, tell me about a time when the light will shine, when the light will shine. Tell me about a time when the light will shine, when the light will shine. Deep pockets got the fate of a blue dog with hot, hot danger. Tell me about a time.
Want to change, there ain't no one way to do it. And when the lost migrate, the Titans won't help them through it. Disparity in spades, many will lose, some will gain. Where the money stays, bread will break, but hope still wanes.
Once upon a time all across the land, the people rose up and they clapped their hands. They looked to the sky and said, who's gonna make sure that we're fit? Cause it's dark and it's stormy and the rain's about to fall. After drought, there's no money and our backs are against the wall. Oh no, big oil and Monsanto, Snapchat plans as they go. Big states and lines in the sand, the people force their greed. All the people say, tell me about a time
when the light will shine,
when the light will shine. Tell me about a time
when the light will shine,
when the light will shine. Deep pockets got the fate of a blue dot with hot, hot days. Tell me about a time. Tell me about a time
when the light will shine,
when the light will shine. Tell me about a time when the light will shine, when the light will shine. Deep pockets got the fate of a blue dog with hot, hot days. Tell me about a time when the light will shine.
Yeah. Thank you. There's some dancing just in case you want to join along. It's awesome. Thank you. So, 10 years after Titans, 20 years later, 30 years later maybe, we start to really, really feel the impacts of climate change. And for all the best laid plans and all the things we try to do to stop climate change from happening, it's still going to happen. Even if the decisions made in Paris have great strides and good commitments and even action following. So there will still be impacts. And we started to think about what could that future look like. And this song plays out in our future, maybe when we're about 80 years old and we've raised a family and we're thinking about what happened.
Years.
So, well, here. So I'm in your shoes. And that's what this song is about, and it's called These Eyes.
A tapestry by Adam's hand in disbelief. We could not plant in shifting sand, passing through Titan's hands. A sort of crumble with these eyes, I reawaken to deltas dry. God's angry. Promises. Security. With control. Tyranny. I saw it all come up with these eyes. I reawaken to a different life. I saw it all crumble with these eyes. In the end, we will to go. Unlike Maddie, we'll have a another leash I try to hold. A rush of gold. The last tree burning peat. A lively sea. Bankruptcy. A subtle crumble.
Time.
7:20.
Okay, we've got a bit of time.
So, yada yada yada. Everything's, you know, everybody's kind of come through it a little. We're decades and decades after Paris, and there's a, at the end of our album, we've put a little kind of an ode, a song that's fun to sing. It is reflective of the whole story of, you know, we struggled, we had issues, cultural issues, consumerism, things of that nature. But in the end, it's kind of hope and love that brings people together. And the large dream of this project of ours, this is a song that is simple to sing, and we would hope that people might take this song to Paris. They might march in the streets with this song. We being in New York was the whole motivation for this album, and we're hoping that we can just contribute to Paris with music. And this is the song we hope somebody will sing there.
And feel free to sing along.
Yeah. It's really easy.
Dollar.
For us. Again, we're Dan, Jane, Heather, Lynn, and the album that we just finished recording is called Decades After Paris, and we're hoping to release that in the next month or two.
Pretty soon. Yep. Come on.
We got some. It'll be on iTunes and available through us. We'll bike courier over to anyone's house. We have to do that for all the Kickstarter backers that we're so fortunate to have. Yeah, for sure. Also, if you call the CBC and request the song Paris Takes the Stage, they've spun that once, and hopefully they'll spin it again. Yeah,
it's all good. And eventually, though, the music will be available to anybody who wants to sing to it, dance to it in Paris. So if you happen to be there, it'll be there available for free.
And thanks, Ben and Sasha, and everyone who organized this event. It's great to have us here. We really appreciate that. And it looks great.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello? Okay. Danton and Heather, thank you so much. That was just awesome. Love you. Amazing. We'll be looking for Decades After Paris for sure. Welcome everybody to C's event. We're all here for one purpose, and that is to love our coast. And tonight I'm really excited to be here I am wearing my sea hat right now, and I have a couple of announcements to make. Social Environmental Alliance is a political platform where individuals in the community can come and bring their concerns to, and they can have backup, they can have people, organizers to help support the things that are important to them. I encourage everyone to become a member of SEA, it's really important backup. Also, tonight, this room, it costs $171, I believe, so we're going to be passing around a bucket just to try and recoup some of those costs. Now I'm going to put on my other hat here tonight. I am a major gift fundraiser for Raincoast Conservation Foundation, and tonight I am happy to be here with two of my colleagues, Lori Waters and Ross Dixon. We'll be presenting a movie, and there's other things going on here. But I wanted to talk about Raincoast for a moment. Recently, in the last 3 months, I kind of jumped ship from the farmland conservation movement for a little bit, and I've been working on protecting the coastal waters and species of British Columbia, which are extremely at risk, which we're going to see in this movie coming up here. I think one of the most compelling things that I have learned so far in Raincoast is science can really inform us and inspire action. One of our scientists, Dr. Angie Rosenberg, he's done a spill cart experiment. He's released 400 spill carts around the Burnaby Inlet area. And these spill carts are to simulate an oil spill. And we let them out because we wanted to know how the oil is going to travel and where is the accumulation zone. And we've been finding out that a lot of the accumulation zone, the majority of the accumulation zone, is in the Salish Sea, and it's right around our neighborhood. And for our purpose here tonight, this is also the critically endangered habitat for the southern resident killer whales. And so that's why I'm here tonight. I'm standing on behalf of that. We're all here to protect the Salish Sea, but I encourage you all to jump on board, become a member, and together we can all protect the southern resident killer whales. I have forms there, and there's other great organizations here tonight as well, and I hope we get to hear from all of them. Thank you very much. Ross Dixon from Raincoast is now up here.
Yeah, thanks, Natalie. Thanks to Torrance for reminding us to start the evening recognising that we're on the unceded territory of the Legolden territories and the Esquimalt and Songhees nations. So thanks for the reminder. You can probably tell by my accent that I'm not a local. I just wanted to, there's never a free event, so I'm one of the guys with the PowerPoints. I just wanted to give you a sense of, where this story of the directly affected film came from, and also just encourage you to consider looking at it with a different lens. I'm not going to go into the huge part of what Raincoast does. Our whole mission is to protect the land, waters, and wildlife of coastal BC, and we have a load of really great and viral propaganda just over there on the table. Please take some. So basically, the directly affected film and initiative really started about over a year ago when groups like Raincoast and Sierra Club and the Wilderness Committee were going all around BC talking to groups just like you guys, supporting them to try and answer this question that the National Energy Board told them that they would have to answer: how are you directly affected? And really that just gave us a seed, because actually the question is really quite a fantastic question if you remove the limits. If you remove the limits and say, well, really you can say whatever you want about how you're directly affected by things like pipelines and climate change, and there doesn't need to be a limit on how you share that. And really what we were picking up on is just the frustration of all those people, certainly myself included, that felt that real frustration by being told that their voice didn't matter, and how they thought that they were directly affected was being shut out of a what's supposed to be a public process. So really we're just responding to people like you guys and trying to tap into that frustration and turn it around and give people the opportunity to share how they're directly affected in the hope that it inspires others to think how they're directly affected. This is the image of a Vancouver oil spill, and it's kind of that everyone told you so moment. In many ways, although an oil spill is never great, it really came at a useful moment in time and just highlighting the fact that we are woefully inadequate in our response capacity, and the way we respond to these things is certainly a long, 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 long way from world class. When the US Coast Guard and Washington State are telling you that your spill response is 20 to 30 years behind theirs, you can recognize that it's not world class. Yeah. So in many ways, this kind of really started to give us the idea about how are we directly affected by an oil spill or just this increase of tanker traffic through the Salish Sea. And as Natalie mentioned, a couple of years ago, we really started to think about this question. If there was an oil spill, where would it actually go? Like, how could we actually start to understand that? Because we didn't have the resources to model an oil spill because it cost tens of thousands of dollars. So what else could we do to actually raise people's awareness of what an oil spill might look like and to try and understand where all might go? So we took these. I've got a prop in my bag. I've wanted one of these for so long, and I finally got one. So these are our drift cards. This is exactly what they look like. We throw these in the ocean, and every single one has a distinct number that tells us exactly where it was dropped. And we launched this with youth from the Tsleil-Waututh First Nation and Burrard Inlet. That's our research vessel, the Achiever. And this shows you, like, in addition to points in Port Metro Vancouver the Port of Vancouver, we dropped them along areas that are known to have basically higher vessel traffic risk, generally because of the volume of traffic or a navigational challenge. We also dropped them in English Bay because there's a chance of fueling incidents in Vancouver Harbour. And I have to show you this slide because my colleague spent weeks on it. And I have to remind you that it's not actually to scale. But it just makes the point, all those red triangles are basically areas that we drop the drift cards. And when people recover them, it allows us to build up a much bigger picture of where all might go. So this just shows you where some of the cards ended up from when we dropped them just opposite where the Fraser River meets the Salish Sea. And you can see they kind of keep going. And just in terms of so the Vancouver oil spill gave us a pretty sad, stark reminder of what a spill might look like in Vancouver. And Kinder Morgan gave us this as well. This image is from Kinder Morgan's own spill modeling that they submitted to the National Energy Board, much of which we don't agree is necessarily an accurate picture of a spill. Their spill scenarios are basically it's the worst accident they think could happen. It's very, very far from what you would do in the States, which would be a worst case scenario. But this is what it looks like. Yeah, it gives you an idea of the spatial extent of a spill just from Kinder Morgan's own information. So basically they run the model time and time and time again, and the area where it's black is where 95% of the times they run the model, oil is found. And when you move out to those lighter colors, there's less chance of oil appearing. But you have to remember, this is just one spill scenario, which is very far from a worst case scenario.
How many barrels would that be?
I think that's 10,000 barrels, which just happens to be aligned with the response capacity, which is a lot less than is actually in the vessels.
Yeah.
That's modelled at Turn Point. At Turn Point, so in the where the tanker is there. Unfortunately so. More like 750,000. Yeah. So it gives you an idea of the difference. And this is where the drift cards end up. If you look, I always speak for longer than I think. But if you look on the west coast of Vancouver Island, you can see that the drift cards that we dropped in the same place where that spill was modeled keep going. And it doesn't necessarily mean that we're not necessarily saying that an oil spill in that area would oil that whole area, but it does give you an idea about the connectivity of the ocean environment and what's affecting the the movement of things on the surface of the ocean, which is winds and surface currents. And they ended up in Haida Gwaii as well. So it gives you an idea about how connected this whole system is. Although we haven't shown these on here, we've actually found some of them in Alaska as well. So it gives you an idea about these are cards that we dropped in the Gulf Islands, travel all the way up the coast, all the way to Alaska. For this one, I think so. The Kinder Morgan model stops after 16 days. And that's part of the problem, that it kind of assumes that you're going to stop doing everything you can after 16 days. It assumes a lot of things. It also assumes that the oil will stay on the surface of the water. So I'm conscious of time, but I just wanted to make the point. If you can remember what the map looked like for the oil spill, the area in red is the critical habitat of the southern resident population of killer whales that's designated in both the US and Canada. Gives you a pretty good idea about what the risk is. And although it's easy to focus on the risk of an oil spill, Kinder Morgan's own application tells us that the risk to the southern residents just from acoustic disturbance from the vessels is high probability, high magnitude, and significant. And that's their words in their own assessment. So when we think about killer whales for just as one example, it's not just the impact from an oil spill. We have to think about it in a wider context. And I remember now the reason for bringing killer whales is that when we think about how we're directly affected, we kind of do that for a human lens. And I really encourage everyone, when looking at this question, about thinking about what else is directly affected. So the killer whales, Natalie mentioned, we're doing a huge amount of work on them with partners. This population was the one that was where many were taken for the aquarium trade in the 70s. It's also recognized as one of the most polluted populations of marine mammals in the world, which is not a great achievement. And basically they face a myriad of threats, including the reduction of Chinook salmon, which is the principal food source. All these vessels, large and small, so it's not just the large vessels that are an issue, it's this multitude of vessels. So when we think about the Kinder Morgan project, we also need to think about the context of just simply the increase in vessel traffic and what that means for things like killer whales. And so Natalie mentioned this. We don't really talk about this in great deal in the directly affected film, but I wanted to mention it because I've got the microphone. And this is a major part of our work this year, is that we've been waiting for a long time. We took the federal government to court to force them to enact their own legislation around species at risk for this population of killer whales, which is critically endangered. And we're kind of tired of waiting. So with lots of other groups, what we're doing now is we're not going to wait for the federal government to keep delaying the recovery plan. We're effectively just creating our own and starting to deliver it. Yeah, it is really cool, and it's a combined effort. It's not just Raincoast, it's other groups that you see in the room, and it's kind of sad that it comes to that charities are having to do this work, but it's also compelling because it's something that we can all very easily support. Damn. Okay, I got some ahs, but I always show that slide at the beginning because usually everyone goes, ah, oh, because it's a wolf. And it's also the, you know, I think for myself, there's a reason I came to Canada, just what inspired me to do what I do at Raincoast. And I guess what the point I wanted to make with this slide is, I think that's the real power of the directly affected movie when you think about it. Information is really important, but really the whole idea is if you can connect to what, how you're personally directly affected by this type of proposal, you may well be frustrated with, you know, a totally shoddy review process with the feeling that it's going to get rammed through anyway. But if we can connect to what we're, how we're really directly affected individually and personally, we can really turn that around and motivate us, use that as a motivation to actually do something positive. And that's what we see all over. So we're just in the process now of taking the movie right across the country to Halifax to connect with all these other groups that are directly affected by Energy East. And in all those other communities, we say we see the same thing. People are directly affected, and they're using that to motivate their own change. So that's what I really encourage you guys to consider when you watch this film. Recognizing that we're directly affected is one thing. The key trick is to understand how we can use that to motivate change. So now you're going to get to watch the movie.
Alberta. It was logical that a pipeline be run to the great seaport city of Vancouver, who had always had to import all but a small fraction of the oil they consumed. But before any physical work could be done on public or private property, mutually satisfactory arrangements for easements had to be made.
Kinder Morgan has applied to the National Energy Board to build a new 590,000 barrel per day bitumen-based export-only crude oil pipeline from Edmonton to Burnaby. The Conservative government radically overhauled the NEB pipeline approval process and made a real mess of things.
There are 2,200 properties in BC that could be impacted.
There's a lot of costs. There's a lot of externalities. There's a lot of risk that the people along the route take on.
The world's newest petro-state and a changing country.
It is in this country's national interest to be able to sell products to the biggest growing markets in the world, and those are in Asia.
What do I do? Like, do I help? Do I try to get rich while increasing carbon pollution into the atmosphere? Or do I try to stop it, slow it down?
Kinder Morgan, it's a $100 billion enterprise company. Transports, handles, stores, produces oil.
The cheapest, most effective, long-term way of moving all these products is by pipeline.
I didn't even know what bitumen was at that point. Everyone was talking about bitumen, and I put my hand up and said, excuse me, I don't know what that is.
But how much difference is there between the Kinder Morgan proposal and the Enbridge proposal?
Well, the Kinder Morgan proposal is bigger. It's close to 1 million barrels per day.
We have to convince a broad group of people that it's okay. It's okay. This project's okay, and here's why.
This project is not in the best interest of Canadians. Not from an economic standpoint, an environmental standpoint, a social standpoint, a political standpoint, or even a democratic standpoint, because to force this project through, the Harper government has to pretty much trample on all of that.
There was a great hammering on the door. It was a firefighter. All he said was, evacuate immediately. There's been an oil spill. My daughter was downtown, and I had to tell her, don't come home. But it was only listening to the news that I got some idea of what was happening. It was horrific to go through that, and to see your whole neighborhood torn apart, and to see how scary it was, not really realizing the danger that was there. After a couple of years, things settled down, and we didn't talk about it anymore. And then, 5 years later, we find out about this expansion.
The pipeline crosses our land. You can see the yellow marker there.
Well, this pipeline comes all the way from Edmonton, but it runs through the Lower Mainland from Hope to Burnaby.
The actual route is going to go under the Lions Gate Bridge, go round about this away and out like that. And they say, you know, like once it gets out here, it's not a problem. But this is a hugely treacherous coast. This whole coast is called the Graveyard Coast because of all the sunken ships. So anyway, on to China.
By understanding the dynamics of what's happening to the bull kelp and the threats to the bull kelp, we get a better grasp of what's happening to Mother Earth. They are a carbon sink. It's estimated that the kelps, including the seagrasses, produce about 70% of the world's oxygen. And of course, an oil spill will do huge damage.
The Salish Sea is already under all of these stressors. For killer whales, the reason it's part of their critical habitat is because Chinook salmon tend to funnel through here. The same places that ships want to go is the place that salmon and whales go.
What nature provides us is valuable. And if we mess that up, we will have to replace them somehow, and usually at a very high cost.
This is the largest salmon producing river in the world, believe it or not. This generates millions and millions of dollars, not only for the economy of British Columbia, but of Chilliwack itself. And one of the best things for your health is eating wild fish. The pipeline, if we expand it and there's a slide or an earthquake or something, that'll run right into the Fraser. It could kill millions and millions of fish, lost forever.
Pipelines are regulated by us, the National Energy Board, in an environmentally safe way.
The NEB became the sole regulator, so they are now conducting not only their own review, but they're responsible for the environmental assessment, which previously would have been done by the Environmental Assessment Agency.
So these are the three NEB representatives, as far as we understand, that are reviewing this proposal. We've got three people with a pretty heavy experience in oil, gas, and electric power industries.
To short-circuit a due process on a major public policy decision and say things like climate shouldn't be in the discussion is absurd.
I did apply to be an intervener, and like many of my colleagues here at UBC, we were rejected.
This is not an economic benefit versus environmental risk trade-off. This is an economic cost to the Canadian economy and Canadian consumers and businesses with huge environmental risk.
The National Energy Board didn't even send out a press release. They just opened the process, posted on their website without any kind of communication on the day. And there could be very well people living in these other communities that will be directly affected that will have absolutely no say in this at all.
We were the ones who were trying to alert people, and then we were doing their job of telling people that this thing is out there and that you have this possibility of intervening in, you know, the NEB process and give them some feedback and all this kind of thing, and they're complaining about us trying to do that.
16년 동안 살던 것도 파이프라인이 기존에 지나가고 있다는 걸 지금 알게 됐습니다.
우리 해서 이 아래에서 미팅을 가졌는데 전부 다 영어로 얘기가 진행이 됐어요. 그래서
우리가 살던 한국 후진국, 한국은 캐나다 후진국이지만 한국은 국민의 여론을 갖다가 많이 반영해가지고서 모든 큰 프로젝트 하는데 여기는
Within the Korean community, is there much talk about the pipeline?
No.
They have no information. 아무도 몰라요, 지금. 오로지 우리만 알고 있어요.
Well, they are going to dig right down across the whole farm here, so there will be no water back there. And how do the farmers get their produce from that side to this side? To me, it doesn't matter how much money they're going to give you in compensation. It's disruption of your land.
You know, I won't get Kinder Morgan to agree that there is an impact on property value, but I'm sure there will be now that there's talk of the twinning.
I had the National Energy Board in a committee meeting in Ottawa, and I asked them, would you actually force this pipeline through First Nation reserves, send bulldozers through a reserve that didn't want a pipeline? And they did say, you know, they have the power to do this, which is true. You have a group of Canadians that have been so badly treated, holding guns to people's heads is not really a way you should develop infrastructures.
They're not going anywhere. We're not going anywhere. We need to find a way to coexist. And coexist means that we're on equal footing. We have equal access to resources to develop our communities and sustain our communities together.
So after a while, you start to ask, well,
should we be participating in this? Are we not legitimating an illegitimate process by participating?
If you're somebody who cares about the future on this planet and you're humble before science, then you have to recognize we're on a very unsustainable path.
We know we're in the last stages of burning all of these fossil fuels into our atmosphere. We cannot continue to do that. We are really Canada's hub for clean technology, renewable energy companies. We have to see the whole economy shift, and that shift is going to be led by cities.
And I think that our opposition is well-founded because we are deriving all of the impacts and we cannot identify where those benefits will be.
This is one of these great moments in human history, and you guys are absolutely at the white hot center of it. Thank you so, so much.
Capitalism will not work in the long run unless the public interest is taken care of and protected. It will not work. And I have a very strong commitment to the market system and to real economic development. So what you've uncovered there is a very serious concern I have, that the federal government and the National Energy Board that reports to it has been compromised for the benefit of a handful of companies to erode and dismantle our very important, strong economic system. And so the jobs that my kids and my grandkids need in the future will not be there because we've sold them down the pipeline. And the environment that this country has relied on for hundreds of years will be destroyed.
I'm the chair of the CRD's Trans Mountain Pipeline Expansion Working Group. I'm going to be submitting the city's verbal comments to the National Energy Board in September, along with the mayor of Victoria. And on next Wednesday, we're submitting our written submission. The city's position is to formally oppose the application on the basis that it's not compatible with either the economy or the ecology of the city and the Capital Regional District. And so all of those materials will be available on Wednesday, the city's materials, and then the Capital Regional District's materials. Our committee's actually looking at them next week. The board will vote on them in June, and that letter of comment from the regional government will go in July. And so, I'm wearing two hats. Natalie was wearing two hats, I'm wearing four. I have those two elected official roles. I'm also the chairperson of the Social Environmental Alliance, and I'm a member of the organizing committee for the Turning the Tide paddle. And I'm going to invite up Sasha Fakic, who's the chairperson of Turning the Tide, to quickly make a pitch. Tonight we have a couple of hours to have a discussion, and we're going to have a short a few additional slides from another scientist of Raincoast, right after Sasha. And then have more of a dialogue where the speakers from three of the groups are going to be here. They don't have presentations, don't worry. They're going to be here to engage your questions and comments as we figure out collectively what we're going to do about this to conserve the sailor's sea. But Sasha's now going to tell us a little bit about if we want to go beyond these 2 hours and all the great organizers in this room, a five-day opportunity to really mobilize some collective power and goodwill and camaraderie and fun times. So here's Sasha.
Okay, so it's, yeah,
2 hours is fun. Imagine 5 days with some of your closest environmentalist friends, paddling through the Salish Sea, celebrating your love for the coast, and joining our islands in solidarity. This year, Turning the Tide is going to be visiting Salt Spring Island, Main Island, Pender Island. We're going to have community celebrations, much like we did last year, but it's going to be bigger and better. So if you don't already have plans, or if you do have plans for July 24th to the 28th, make sure you cancel them and join Turning the Tide. A few of you went on Turning the Tide last year, so you know how much fun it was, but it's a paddle with a purpose. And it's a nice combination of outdoor enjoyment, good physical exercise, but also a lot of political content, a lot of chances to conspire and inspire and get together. So I'm not going to go on, but I will say this. Visit turningthetide.ca, sign up, get some paddling skills together, get some canoes, kayaks, whatever you want to do, and join us this July. Thanks.
Yeah, it is a truly accessible event. All of the islands that are being visited are serviced by BC Ferries, so even if you can't come for the whole 4 nights and 5 days, Larry and other people I see here came for one or several of the days by a ferry. There's also sailboats, there's even 3 swimmers, Dashiell is one of them, and a number of kayaks and canoes. And so there is a range of ages and abilities that are accommodated. I'm going to invite up Lori Waters with Raincoast. She paddled last year with her partner, Chris, and so we're going to see her. Thanks, Lori.
Great, thanks. Hi, everybody. I strongly encourage everybody to paddle this year. It's such a great time, and it's a really, really good event. It's a really nice chance to finally kind of be out on the water and just enjoy our Salish Sea. We spend so much time fighting for it that it's just great to spend some time being out there and enjoying the flora and fauna that we have. And the flora and fauna that we have in the Salish Sea is very special. It's very abundant. We're very fortunate to have such biodiversity here, and I'm very glad to be part of the community that's collectively protecting it. So the film basically gave a really good overview, so I'm kind of just going to wing it. There's a few things that I want to say about the Kinder Morgan project, about the NEB, about tankers, and about our Salish Sea. And Raincoast, as many of you know, has taken the federal government to court twice, and won against the Department of Fisheries and Oceans. Basically to protect the southern resident killer whales that are supposed to be protected and would be greatly threatened if this project was allowed to go ahead. It should not go ahead, and there's a number of reasons why it shouldn't go ahead. We know many of them. Now, I just want to say something about Richard Kinder. Have any of you seen the Smartest Guys in the Room, that film? Okay, The Smartest Guys in the Room is a film about Enron. Now, I think that Richard Kinder may have been the smartest of the smart guys in the room because he actually left the room before everybody else was arrested and thrown into jail. Now, the reason I like to mention Enron is because it's important to this Kinder Morgan project. Richard Kinder was the brains. If you read the US Senate report, and I can send you this section, about how the whole Enron debacle went on, Richard Kinder was the brains behind it. He's the guy that got the board to buy into it, and he's the guy that made it happen. Now, the reason that's important when you think about the Kinder Morgan project is that this project is Enron 2. So Enron was a company that was designed to shovel money away from the American public and into Richard Kinder and his buddies' pockets. The Kinder Morgan project is designed to shovel money away from the Canadian public and into Richard Kinder's pockets. Now, it does that because they don't pay taxes, and it does that because we bear all of the risk and they get all of the profit. Now, the way that happens, there's a four-tiered system under the federal government that allows, they call it the polluter pay system. Now actually it's a taxpayer pay system. So the way it works is there's $1.34 billion that are available from the polluter to pay in the event of an oil spill. But if you look at the numbers for what a spill would cost to clean up and what the effects on the Canadian economy and the BC economy would be in the event of a spill in Burrard Inlet, it's $40 billion. Exxon Valdez from 1989 to 1993 cost over $2 billion to clean up. So why do we only have $1.34 billion to clean it up? And who picks up the tab? The answer is we do. The other thing that you need to know about that is that we cannot trust a company in Richard Kinder and Kinder Morgan who is hedging their bets. They get all the profit from the pipeline and they profit from a spill. They own 50.9% of Western Canada Marine Response Corporation, which means that part of that money from the polluter pay system is going from this pocket into this pocket. So in the event of a large spill, what happens is they pay themselves to clean up the spill first, and then you and I pay them to clean up the spill after that. And that is why in 2014, in March, Kinder Morgan said as part of their application that they that oil spills are profitable, because it's true, they are. It's a for-profit corporation, and they can tell you all they like about how it's set up that way and it's supposed to be that way, but that's not the fact. It's not a not-for-profit corporation. And one thing that I think that we should be fighting for as a public is to get the oil spill response out of private hands into the hands of the public, because the longer they wait, the more money they make, and they don't have the incentive of the environment, right? So that's Kinder Morgan and oil response. The other thing I wanted to talk about just very briefly is NEB. I prefer to call them the Calgary Pipeline Approval Board, because that's who they are and that's what they do. If you look at the statistics for their decisions, that is what they have done. They approve pipeline projects. They don't have the public good in mind when they make these decisions, and that's very clear from the framework that they put together. And they are not making those decisions for public benefit. So we need to call for the abolishment of the National Energy Board. The National Energy Board Act, if you read it, they are supposed to be a court. They're supposed to be recognized by the judiciary, and they're supposed to have a seal. With that comes responsibility, and you would think that they would have the qualifications to fulfill those responsibilities. But as we saw in the film, the board members are largely made up of petroleum executives, lifelong petroleum executives who don't have the ability to be making lawful decisions. If the NEB is to be a court, they must behave like a court. The Attorney General has already told them that they are not meeting the evidentiary rules because they have not allowed cross-examination. Cross-examination is the gold standard for allowing evidence, because it is what gets at the truth. So by them railroading this process and eliminating cross-examination, they're basically stacking the deck. They're also stacking the deck in Kinder Morgan's favor, because before the application went ahead, what they did was they set up a special fund. And under that special fund, all the tankers coming and going into Vancouver Harbor are paying millions of dollars, and that's all going to Kinder Morgan to prepare for their side. But there wasn't a similar fund set up so that all of the public could prepare their arguments. So the deck is stacked. We need to get rid of the National Energy Board, because they will. They will, given their propensity as the Calgary Pipeline Approval Board, approve the pipeline. And when that happens, we need to be ready to fight it all the way. So I know Ben, wants to get on with the discussion part, and I'm sure that other people have lots of questions, and we want to have a ample time for discussion. So I'll end there. So thank you.
Thank you. I'll invite Lori to take one of the three seats. And Torrance Coste from the Wilderness Committee. And Larissa Stein from the Sierra Club of BC. And we're going to start at first, it's a bit of a dialogue. We're going to start with three sort of softball questions. And I think in the interest of time, we're going to roll those three into one. And then it will be over to you, and then our panelists can come back, and there'll be more room for interaction. So the first question, I guess, we'll put to Larissa, and then the other two will have an opportunity, what do you think the biggest threat is to the Salish Sea, and what is your organization doing about it, and what do you think we all should be collectively doing about it?
Okay, thanks, Ben. Well, obviously, not just the Salish Sea, but the biggest threat we're all facing is climate change, and we realize that. But looking one level below that, of course, tankers, pipelines, all this infrastructure that's facilitating carbon-heavy activities, which contribute to climate change, are obviously a problem. In the tangible sense, we've just saw in the film, spills are inevitable. We know that. It's not a question of if, it's really a question of when, and it's a question of magnitude. And, you know, I think all of the graphics really display how totally ill-equipped we are. We saw exactly how ill-equipped we were in English Bay. So there's many a threat. And I always find it so interesting that when you look at any of these models and or the assumptions that are made, they're always skewed to the benefit of the proponent. Always, always. They never, ever really do take the most severe, you know, projections into consideration. It's always completely minimized, and we can see that they're just completely ill-prepared. If you look at even what just happened on the weekend with all of these Coast Guard closures, there was a period of time where there was a complete communications blackout, and that's affecting everything from small pleasure crafts to big tankers, and that's because they're dealing with old technology and they have no capacity. So the fact that the government has been diminishing the capacity to deal with this while promoting this superpower, energy superpower ideology, is completely at odds with any kind of public interest idea. So obviously we are working to fight that. Are we going through all?
I think so, yeah.
All three questions right
for
now?
Sure.
Okay, so I'll continue this spiel. And obviously, and looking at the NEB, so a lot of the stuff we're doing is a bit diverse at Sierra Club. There's a major problem with the fact that they also refuse to disclose the emergency plans. It's ridiculous in so many ways, and so many municipalities and the cities have all sort of cried about this because gives them no opportunity to reflect on what kind of risks are at play and to develop a strategy for their citizenry. And it makes no sense because they provided that to Washington State. So any argument around it being a security issue or whatnot is completely ridiculous. So there's some real problems with the way that this has been set up, and we've been working with a bunch of other organizations on a collective strategy around Kinder Morgan to try to figure out what are some of the tactical ways that we can approach this. One thing we've been working on quite a bit is a flaws document, just looking at the process and how flawed this process is just from start to finish. In Enbridge was flawed in the joint review panel, and since all the omnibus bills have come through, it just has been eroded in terms of any kind of public participation, indigenous rights issues, you name it, across the board, it's an embarrassment as a process. It's all these five conditions that were put up by Christy Clark are impossible to meet. We have no terrestrial or obviously no marine capacity to deal with these spills. So, you know, there's so many problems with this. So we are working quite a bit on unpacking some of those flaws and really discussing how undemocratic and rigged and unfair this is, that there's so many interveners that, as you flagged, are having to pay out of their own pocket to try to wade through this messy project. You mentioned that they've done away with cross-examination. They've also done away, in lieu of cross-examination, they've had these opportunities to file information requests. Well, these information requests are a total joke. And, you know, for example, I think it was EcoJustice that asked about what kind of problems you could see with the impacts on fish in a spill. And their response was like a one-liner about, well, we only in the very worst case scenario do we expect any problems with fish. And that was it. That was their whole commentary on what the impacts to fish are. And so many out of the there were about over 2,000 questions that were not answered that people asked, people, businesses, indigenous groups, you know, took the time and personal expense to be engaged with this. And they said, we didn't get our questions answered. And the NEB only forced Kinder Morgan to answer 5% of those questions. So out of those 2,000 questions, 115 were answered. Ridiculous. And there's no opportunity to go back and forth with this. So it's just a ridiculous process. So that's something we're working on quite a bit. And we also have our Enbridge campaign, which has been pretty exciting. I'm sure you guys have heard about Pull Together, and I'm happy to talk a bit more about that. We've been supporting, along with Raven, seven of the eight Indigenous lawsuits against Enbridge. which is really exciting because it's building a lot of solidarity across, you know, the settler community, as well as amplifying the voices of the First Nations up there, who are really operating in all of our interests, fighting these lawsuits. And so what we're trying to do is help support them by lending some voice to this, and to also help raise some money, because all of these lawsuits are crazy expensive, and we know that. And so Pull Together has been really exciting. Since August, we've raised collectively with people doing spaghetti dinners and dances, and like, it's really, the thing is, it's really fun. This isn't, we're stopping this pipeline in a really fun way and building solidarity and community. And we've raised almost $400,000 since then, so that's pretty amazing. Yeah. I didn't actually do it. But no, it's really thrilling. And so another thing that we are working on, coming back to Kinder Morgan, is that, but it's not just about Kinder Morgan, really. We discussed briefly the equivalency agreement that's allowed the NEB to use sort of this review as the entire environmental review, which is not great. Obviously, they don't really have the capacity to do this in an efficient and thorough way, on top of all this other stuff, because they've also been reduced in terms of their capacity. Their funding has been cut, so they're expected to do more with less. You know, it's not a simple situation for them either. But there's an issue around, like, we don't need this process to be done at that level. The province under the equivalency agreement can actually opt out. And so we have a petition at the back that is calling on the province to pull out of this flawed equivalency agreement and instead institute a BC review, one that includes all of our voices and demonstrates that democratic aspect, as well as really looking into a bit more of some of the local impacts that might exist. And the secondary part of that is also that we've asked for a climate test to be applied to all energy infrastructure that's potentially being funded largely by the public purse as well. And then that also plays into the fact that there's LNG and there's all this heavy, carbon-heavy infrastructure that locks us into this system for the duration. And so the final thing that I'll talk about that we're doing at Sierra Club is we've really been focusing, a lot of my role this spring in particular has been on the solutions piece, because the fact is, you know, they talk about these pipelines and these projects being inevitable. They're not inevitable. What is inevitable is the shift to green tech, to healthy communities, to resiliency, to sustainability. That has to happen. Yeah. So it's pretty exciting because, you know, Mayor Greger talked about how this will be driven by cities, and internationally it is. The cities movement is really powerful for driving this, because that's a locus where people feel empowered, that they have some connection to the democracy that they're seeing, and that they have some influence on what's going on. But in this tour that we did called The Future is Here, where I went to, I think it was 7 communities, including this room, and highlighted some of the stuff that's going on, and every community in BC is thinking this way and has amazing forward-thinking activities going on. And so we were bringing together organic farmers, people installing solar panels locally, you know, the municipal sustainability plans, like, and it's so inspiring, and it's such a gift that I get to go around and meet all these people that are really engaged at the ground level in articulating this new vision, because we're not locked into this. And that's sort of maybe where I want to leave you. So what you can do, the last sort of part of the question, what can you do? Sign the petition, hold a Pull Together event, come out to rallies, like write your MLA. Just expressing our displeasure about the way this is playing out is really a big thing, because it's clearly, it's just a sham. It's just ridiculous. And there is no way to overcome these logistics with more technology. It's an inevitable mess. Mm-hmm. At a time when there are so many clean, resilient, beautiful community building options available, it's completely flawed thinking. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've already talked a bit about what Raincoast is and what Raincoast does, but Raincoast is primarily a science organization. So the way I like to think about it is, essentially, Raincoast is doing the science that the government is no longer doing. So we design experiments and we run them and we publish the results in peer-reviewed journals, and then we use that to do what we call informed advocacy. So we push for policy change based on evidence. We like evidence-based decisions rather than decision-based evidence. So that's what we like to do sort of as a general rule. Now, with respect to Kinder Morgan, I already said that we are interveners. Now, what that means from our standpoint is that we spend a lot of time doing science specifically to disprove or to flush out statements that Kinder Morgan has made. For example, one of the statements that they have made with respect to the spill model that's pictured on the poster at the left there, the top one, one of the statements that they made was that the worst case scenario was a 16% spill, or two tanks of an Aframax tanker. Well, I can give you lots of examples of double hull tanker spills where the majority of the hulls have breached. There are plenty of them, and in some of my tanker talks, I've showed some beautiful pictures of them sitting on the bottom of the ocean. There's one San Jorge tanker spill outside of Uruguay where all but one of the hulls breached. And this is important information that we need to make sure that not only the public knows, but that we, when Kinder Morgan makes a worst case scenario statement like that, we can say, well, what about this worst case, or this worst case, or this worst case, that are all based in reality. See, I think one of the things that we try to do is reflect reality rather than the dream world that Kinder Morgan would like us to accept. So as far as the Salish Sea, we are very concerned about the flora and fauna of the Salish Sea because it is such an area rich in biodiversity, especially Harrow Strait. Harrow Strait is a very active area. There's a lot of upwelling. It has some of the strongest currents in the region. In fact, those currents are on the very hairy edge of what the Kinder Morgan and the NEB say that an Aframax tanker would be able to handle. Basically 2.5 knots is pushing it for an Aframax tanker, and Harrow Strait often exceeds that in spring tides. So these are the types of information that we're trying to bring forward. What I've been working on recently with respect to our actual filings for Kinder Morgan is elucidating some of the information with respect to the southern resident killer whales. Many people don't understand how tenuous the existence of this species is. There are only 80 animals. There have been some births recently, but we don't count them as official births until the animal reaches 6 months, because there's a 50% death rate among young below 6 months. So we are trying to make it clear that if this species is to survive, this project cannot go ahead. So that means flushing out the risks from a scientific standpoint. So we've been working with the best population viability professors in the world, and we put together a true population viability assessment for the southern resident killer whales, and we brought in a lot of other data to flush out the other threats that they face, such as overfishing, because honestly, humans are the greatest threat to their diet, because we eat their food. Where we have other food sources, they can't really go and buy a TV dinner. So we use science to make sure that the facts are out there and that we can prove that really there is, if in good conscience, there is no way that the decision could be made in favor of the pipeline. So that's what we do as far as the Kinder Morgan file. And as I mentioned before, we have, with other organizations, taken different entities to court. And we will continue to do that. And I think I can say here that One of the reasons we prepare evidence is not simply so that we can file it with the NEB, it's so that it can be used in future, should that need arise. So Raincoast is more than prepared to use its science in the court, and we've been successful doing that in the past, and that's something that we would do again. So I think I'll leave it there.
So the biggest threat to the Taylor seat, I wish I had sat further down the table. Larissa said it before I could say it, it's climate change. It is climate change. We're a coastal area here, coastal communities, and that's just it. When entities like the National Energy Board, like the federal government, speak about oil spill response, my eyes kind of glaze over. Right? If the Kinder Morgan terminal gets expanded, it'll ship close to 900,000 barrels a day of oil to the coast, and 900,000 barrels a day are going to spill. Some of it might spill here in the Salish Sea if we're unlucky, but every single drop of it's going to spill into the climate. It's going to affect us, maybe not as quickly, maybe not as graphically and as easy to visualize, but it's going to affect us like an oil spill would through climate change. When we started to look at that, we said if we're gonna oppose Kinder Morgan based on climate, we have to start looking around this region. The Salish Sea, you can see from the map there, it's a neat region, and it is like a bottleneck. It is like a corridor. And unfortunately, Kinder Morgan isn't the only fossil fuel export project proposed for the region. When you look at the Vancouver area and south of the border, which I can't see if it's on that map.
It is, yeah.
Could we get one of the early slides up that gives us more of the Salish Sea, just while Torrance is?
Cool, yeah.
So a number of us seem to be referring to that.
We try and take the Canada-US border off a lot of the maps that we produce, because the orca whales don't see that. Atmospheric carbon dioxide doesn't recognize that. It would kind of be nice if it did. We take that border off because it's easier to visualize how much carbon is going to move through this area as a geographic region. The Keystone XL pipeline, which goes through the center of the continent, is proposed to go through the center of the continent, and has really become the center of the climate justice fight in the United States and really across the continent, would ship a great deal of carbon. In the Salish Sea, between proposed LNG terminals, tar sands terminals like Kinder Morgan, and coal, thermal coal export facilities, there's the equivalent of 3 Keystone XLs proposed on paper to come through the Salish Sea. If that happens, unfortunately, the prospects of a spill, you know, is going to have to be overlaid over an already devastated waterway, over an already already battered communities through climate change. When you extend that further north in British Columbia up to the Alaska border with projects like Northern Gateway and all the LNG terminals, it goes up to 5 Keystone XL. So that's what we have on the table. That's daunting, but we also see it as really hopeful and inspiring, because given that there's a disproportionate amount of carbon slated to be shipped through this region, we who live in this region, between Seattle, Vancouver, Victoria, and all the other wonderful places in between, have a disproportionate amount of power to have an impact on a healthy climate in our future. So when we started to flush this out and to look at a strategy of fighting for the Salish Sea on a climate, from a climate perspective, we came up with the Save the Salish Sea campaign and our Save the Salish Sea pledge. What the pledge does is connect people like all of you in this room, like people in similar rooms in Seattle and Vancouver, and again, everywhere else in between, and get them talking about this, get them working together, because it's people in these kind of rooms that are gonna stop these kinds of projects, that are gonna stop climate change in the Salish Sea. The really quick story that I'll use to kind of highlight that is one about an amazing woman named Paula Williams, who lives in Surrey, and she, a few years ago, was dropping by a rec center to pick up her children, I think from karate or dance or something like that, and she had her schedule mixed up and she showed up an hour early. Right, so her kids weren't going to be finished for an hour. She kind of was looking for something to do. She wandered a few doors down the hall in the rec center and walked into a town hall meeting similar to this on coal exports. There's huge coal export proposals in her community, Surrey Fraser Docks, which would have a huge implication on our climate. She sat in on the meeting. She came and talked, spoke with one of my colleagues, Owen in Vancouver, about the issue, and she essentially became a lightning rod for that campaign in that community. She came into our office in Vancouver several times. She learned as much as she could about the issue, learned as much as anyone really, any citizen knows about the issue, and started organizing on her own. She now has an email list and a petition with 25,000 signatures on it. She's a force to be reckoned with in that community. Essentially, what our Solar Seat Pledge is about is streamlining that process, is creating more people like her, because the organizations that are here tonight, Turning the Tide, the Social Environmental Alliance, Raincoast, Sierra Club, ourselves at WC, they're amazing organizations filled with amazing people doing amazing work. But part of what we're going to need to stop climate change on the Salish Sea is a Paula Williams in every community, from Surrey to Seattle to Squamish to Port Coquitlam to Port Renfrew and everywhere in between. That's what's gonna help us on this issue. That's what our pledge is all about. Emily's got a table full of pledge sheets at the back of the room. Sign one before you leave. Grab a couple, get them filled out, and bring them back to our office in a couple weeks. And we can do this, but we're going to have to do it together. So I'm really excited to be sitting here with my colleagues in this movement and to meet all of you here tonight. Thanks.
Thank you. So we have just a bit less than a half hour for your questions and comments. There is a proposal if people want to continue to convene more informally. There's a nice progressive watering hole about two blocks that way at 768 Yates Street. Cenote is a lounge downstairs next to the Odeon Theater, so you're all welcome and encouraged to participate for non-alcoholic or stronger beverages. And I'm going to just take one of these mics down and so we can hear everyone. I see Ray wants to speak, also Joan, and you keep your comments and questions brief, and the panel can selectively or all, but try to we can keep the responses from the panelists brief to get everyone's comments.
I don't have a really great answer for you. However, I think that it's worth flagging that, you know, Prince Rupert is a much easier port than Kitimat. So, you know, make a lot of noise about why Kitimat is less ideal makes it seem like, oh, well, no, we concede Prince Rupert is an easier choice. So I wonder if there isn't going to be something of that nature around the point that you're making, that it, like, do you know what I'm saying? No, but I'm granted there's that too, but I'm just saying in terms of logistics, they propose a really complicated place that they don't really intend to go to say like, oh, well, we'll go to this easier place, and then it makes it streamlined. Do you know, I'm just saying there's like potentially some psychology at play here.
Bait and switch.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I think one of the problems with placement of these projects, and when we look at placement and say, well, we don't want it here, we have to keep in mind that the other community where we're proposing it doesn't want it either. And I think the thing that bothers me about those kinds of questions is that it essentially means that you're pitting one community against another. And I don't think that that's a productive way to move forward when we collectively, as a people, understand that we simply don't want these projects. So I think if we turn that on its head a little bit, we might make more progress. If we say we're not going to allow these projects anymore in BC, in Washington, in California, in Montana, in North Dakota or South Dakota or anywhere else, and we are going to transition to clean energy. We are going to stop subsidizing the fossil fuel industry. We're going to stop subsidizing the tar sands. And instead, we're going to put that into renewable energy, and we are going to get off fossil fuels. Because I think that's one of the only ways that we are going to stop pitting community against community when we work together instead towards solutions. The other part of the question about tankers and second narrows, I take your point. So I don't know if people saw the report that came out this past week, but there was a really good report done by the City of Vancouver that talked about what would happen in the event of a spill in English Bay, in Burrard. And so you quantified the spill that happened in English Bay. And the best way I could quantify it so people could picture it is that spill that happened, they were saying, in essence, that it was the size of a refrigerator and a stove. So if you look at that, and then look at the model that they did this past week and the report that went with it, you see the animation of where the spill went. And I really encourage people to go and find that animation and look at it, because it will give you the perspective of what happens with tides and oils. That oil is going to go everywhere, and you get to see it flow into the bays and flow out, and you get to see how it coats more and more, 2,000 gallons at a time, until the whole place is coated with oil. And that's what would happen. When you go and look at that animation, you're looking from the top down, so you're seeing the oil flow back and forth in the bay. Keep in mind that the oil is not just going to float. And the tidal action, especially in Harrow Strait, is so strong, and because of the way the flow works, that there's strong upwelling currents and strong down currents. So when you're looking at the animation, think in 3D, because what you're seeing is not just the swirling on the surface. Imagine the oil also going down to the bottom and up. So it affects everything from all of the benthic organisms that live in the bottom of the ocean, everything pelagic, so everything that's living in the marine environment of the ocean, and then everything on the surface, so all of the seabirds and everything that feeds. So I encourage everybody to go and look at that, that animation, just to help you understand for yourself and to see for yourself what oil does in the marine environment. And I take your point about the Second Narrows Bridge. It's very dangerous. And Aframax tankers are not allowed to go through there fully laden. They're only allowed to go through it with a 70% load. And when they go through there with a 70% load, at some tides, there's only a meter between the bottom of the hull and the bottom of the ocean.
To briefly address your concern, your question about the why an option like Cherry Point south of the border isn't being looked at. One of the reasons that could be the case is that the United States, when we look at fossil fuel export projects south of the border, one of the key differences is that in the United States, the review body, which the kind of equivalent to the National Energy Board, is the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, which I was surprised about. They, when reviewing a project, are legally mandated to look at climate change, to encompass climate change, which is a lot of the reasoning behind funneling of fossil fuel exports up to Canada, right? The Powder River Basin, which is in Wyoming and Montana, is one of the dirtiest, most carbon-intensive fossil fuels in the world, and it's getting harder and harder to export from California, Oregon, Washington, which is why you're seeing proposals north of the border in BC. To echo Lori and Larissa, the question of, you know, why aren't we looking at other options, that's something that I wouldn't agree with. We need to be, instead of talking about how to ship this safely, I think we need to be talking about how to leave it in the ground, how to make it work. I know.
That was another
rhetorical.
It's a little bit like leaving out the islands of a kingdom.
Yes, rhetorical. So with our 12 minutes remaining, I'm going to turn it to Joan for all seven questions. The first one, who's going to Paris?
Not it. Anybody want to fund it?
It's an interesting idea, and I like the idea. It's good food for thought.
Torrance?
So. Three weeks ago, found out I was chosen for the Canadian Youth Climate Delegation.
Awesome.
Yay!
So, maybe we'll have a fundraiser to fundraise 2 weeks of leave so we can put Torrance on the ship to release him from the Wilderness Committee. But if he has to go by plane, he'll do good work over
there. It's a huge honor to join that 15 other young Canadians who are going to be over there. I'm personally going to take it to bring the climate change perspective from this part of the world there. And I think we're going to have a really powerful presence.
Awesome. It'll be the only powerful Canadian presence there, I'm sure.
Well, and we'll have our artists, Heather and Danton, will be representing us.
Oh, really? You're not going.
But their CD will be going.
Yeah, exactly. Right on. Great. The next question was from Larry. What do we do in the upcoming federal election?
Well, just briefly, obviously climate change is we want to raise that as an election issue, that this is something that is of concern to Canadians. Poll after poll is recognizing that. There was a recent poll by Dogwood that just, it's coming out on Thursday, that is in a bunch of swing ridings, identified that, like, on average, about 65% of the population is really concerned about climate change and opposed to these projects. So that's pretty encouraging. That's, we've got to send some strong signals is ultimately, and the way we do that is by organizing.
I would echo that, organizing within communities, and I have seen some hopeful signs in other jurisdictions. For example, in Kelowna, a couple of EDAs from different parties have gotten together there to run, to co-run a candidate. Now, it doesn't work perfectly as far as the Elections Act goes, because they are only allowed to list one party on a ballot. However, if there's cooperation at the community level, and if the advertising for that candidate is for multiple parties, then I think that that's one way that we can collectively get some cooperation to get some change in the next election. I think cooperation is the only way we're going to get change in the next election.
I'd echo that as well. Cooperation is a huge piece of it, and when in ridings where there's candidates, some ridings there's candidates that are on the right page with Kinder Morgan with climate change. Sometimes some ridings there's only one, some ridings there's two, some ridings there's none, and to make it politically toxic for politicians not to have progressive stances that are in line with climate science on these issues. Mm-hmm. That's the role of organizations like ours.
And that's a great segue into Joanne's question. So what do you think the likelihood is that the three major opposition parties in Western Canada, the Bloc, I don't know what their policy will be on Kinder Morgan, but in terms of the NDP, the Greens, and the Liberals, what do you think the likelihood is that all three parties would come out against Kinder Morgan?
I don't really like speculating on this kind of stuff, but I think we've already seen that there are parties within that bubble that are not opposed to pipelines. So let's just be cognizant of that when we're looking at national strategy, and really make, again, it's the same answer, make this politically toxic, as you said. It's up to us to make it an issue and to force them to change their opinion.
I think it really depends on how whipped the parties are, and I think that that's one thing that we need to be very aware of moving into elections, is that there are parties who whip their MPs and there are parties who don't, and I would encourage people to vote for parties that allow their people to vote for how their constituents want them to vote, mm-hmm. and with their conscience, and not how their party wishes them to vote.
Yeah, the with a lot of issues, environmental issues, there's knock-on effects in terms of democracy, and with the pipeline issue, this is one of them. How our parties are structured, how much freedom MPs have, and moving into the question, the party positions, you know, the likelihood of them changing is difficult to guess. It's difficult to speculate how likely that would be, but part of this conversation has to be about democratic reform, and it has to be about MPs having freedom to stand for their constituents within their communities.
Thank you. I wrote in the interim, but that was, shifting to alternative sources of energy, particularly for the transportation system in British Columbia.
I think that comes back to also, again, challenging Christie's whole notion of being a climate leader. When all of the plans for LNG and some of these other projects completely undermine any work that's been done on this, and the fact that she's kind of been riding the coattails of earlier policy rather than actually doing anything constructive in the last number of years. So this is where things like the implementation of a climate test is really an important idea. There are other things around that. We do have a really unique opportunity in BC that such a high percentage of our energy is already green. Our electricity is mostly hydro. But that's, again, where we come into some problems particularly around Site C, for example, being such a albatross, frankly, that we're going to end up paying for, that we don't need, that doesn't actually help us as citizens. So it's a pretty complex dynamic, but let's really challenge the current government to stand up to what they are saying that they're about, which would be things like thawing the carbon tax freeze would be one real clear indicator. Also, there's things around like the new climate action team. I think there's some opportunities there for public engagement. So if people want to push the EV, the electric vehicles thing there, that's great. There are some, because the transportation sector is one where we could actually really encourage that. And there used to be a number of subsidies available for people to buy electric vehicles, and those have all gone by the wayside. Encouraging those to be re-implemented, there's lots of ways around this. And the fact is, too, that you know we've seen $5.3 billion invested in green tech and green and renewables in BC since 2009. So that's really impressive. But because our electricity system is already a bit greener than most, we have a leg up to start looking into some of these more progressive options. So again, making that something that your community is really interested in.
This is actually one of the areas where I see the most hope. You know, the first Tesla came out, then the S model came out, and soon the Model 3 will come out. And the Model 3 is designed to be sort of the everyman's car. It's going to be the modern Volkswagen, essentially, an electric car that everybody can have and afford. And I think that that will revolutionize our transportation, or I certainly hope that it will. The other thing that we have in British Columbia is we have probably some of the best opportunity for geothermal. And if we move to that, you know, it starts to eliminate some of the need for things like Site C, which I completely concur is an absolute ridiculous nightmare of a mess that should never see the light of day. So I think we do have a lot of hope. I've been around to some communities and seen some of the community work that people are doing. You know, the fantastic solar array on Gulf Island Secondary School in Ganges. There are other communities who are putting together community solar arrays so that if a person doesn't have the perfect exposure, the south-facing exposure with a 12 and 12 pitch roof to put up their own solar panels, the communities are putting in essentially solar panel farms, and people just pay in for their panels and then get the rebate off their electricity bill. And I think with novel solutions like that, we can turn it around and we can produce the power to get the alternative energy that we're going to need so that we don't have to rely mainly on you know, fossil fuels.
Just to pop... That's where grid tie-in and stuff is pretty interesting. And actually, Ontario grid tie-in, you compare the amount of money that people in grid tie-in in Ontario get, which is about 80 cents versus like, is it like 15 cents or something here? Like, there are all kinds of provincial level policies that can encourage that growth.
It's okay. And there is actually better insulation here. We have better hours of sunlight than Germany does, and mm-hmm. Germany has radically shifted the majority of their energy to solar. So, I mean, I think that there's a perception.
No, the Anegivenda is like this is the difference too between leaving everything to the individual level, choice level, and actually implementing progressive policy at the governmental level. And as much as you want it to be a free market solution, you look at any of these large transitions that have ever happened, and there's always some regulatory framework that has to be engaged. And so again, this is where it becomes a political issue, so we have to be demanding that.
Yeah, but. And I think it can also be an aggregate of services. Like, it doesn't have to be just one source of power. I mean, I think that if we move our communities towards increasing solar, we're doing good. If we move towards geothermal, if we reduce our power usage, we're doing good. We have to work in every single way that we mm-hmm. can to get ourselves off fossil fuels. And we have to work together on that, and I think that that will ultimately be our energy solution.
Sure. And just sorry, I'm just going to pop in for one more second. There is also, it's really interesting to see that there's no cookie cutter. Solar doesn't work for everyone. There is no one place solution. This has got to be a localized, ground up driven thing. And so, you know, looking at the tidal experiments that are being done off Race Rocks and Pender Island, looking at, we're not totally in favor of this, but you know, in the interior, there's all this wood waste, so there's efficient wood waste projects and pellet stoves and stuff. You got to look at what are run of river, small, community-sized hydro. There's lots of stuff, but it's about what works in an individualized community, and that's where that needs to be driven from the ground up. So, sorry, Torrance.
That's okay. I want to talk about the energy usage piece, but I think there was a question, maybe the last question.
The next one.
I'll talk quickly about the about the transit piece. And when I talk about electrified transit, I always immediately start talking about the carbon tax. Because with transit, the big question is, how do we pay for it? Who's going to pay for it? We're seeing a huge fight over the transit referendum in Vancouver, in Metro Vancouver right now. And the carbon tax in BC, which the government loves to laud and say that other jurisdictions are fighting to emulate, it needs to grow. It needs to increase as it was supposed to before they capped it, before they ceased increasing it. But it needs to become, it's what they call a revenue neutral carbon tax. And every budget lockup, they talk about this, and they preach this revenue neutrality. And everyone says, neutral, that's a good word. It's kind of like balanced. What it means is that the government doesn't make money on it. The money that comes in from the carbon tax goes out elsewhere. It often comes to people like us, which is a pretty good vote-getting strategy. When I was in university and I didn't have an income, I used to get, I think, every quarter, like a $120 check from the government of BC as a low-income carbon offset or something. And you know, $120 was nice, but I would have way rather seen that money and all those other checks go into investments in transit, a revenue positive carbon tax where we're taxing at a greater level big polluters, big carbon emitters, and we're investing that directly back into public transit. That's where that money is going to come from.
The last two questions, I think we're going to start with Michael's. What is the oil spill in the vicinity of Santa Barbara on the California coast tell us? And then we'll finish with the consumption question, because I think it moves the discussion in interesting ways about the economic system and ecology and some of the objectives of a number of the groups here today.
You brought that up, because I actually took some notes on that today. I think it's just completely heinous, right? And I think we all do. They spilled 105,000 gallons of crude oil. It was a 24-inch pipe. They burst on Tuesday, and by Wednesday there was a 9-mile plume of oil, and they estimate that it was moving 3 to 4 miles per day. So they've declared a state of emergency, if you haven't heard this already. It's pretty profound. What's interesting about the connection that this has to us is in Canada is that this was the same pipeline company, Plains All American Pipeline, that also spilt in the Lubicon's territory. It was the third largest spill in Canadian history a number of years ago. They've had to pay, they released 1.2 million gallons in that one, and they didn't even inform the community for 3 days. It was a total travesty. It destroyed. That was part of it, yeah. It was right around election time, and there were people having headaches and feeling sick, and they didn't let anybody know, and it was only 3 or 4 kilometers away from their settlement. And this was in a huge wetland area, terrible, and like third largest spill in Canadian history, and this is the same company. And also connecting to what we're talking about tonight, the last major pipeline disaster in the Bay Area was actually a Kinder Morgan pipeline. And that was in 2004, and they spewed 123,700 gallons of diesel into some wetlands as well, and it ruined 224 acres of wetlands. And so, of course, there's huge biological costs to this too, in terms of wildlife, birds, and in this case, marine mammals. So, and that spill is going straight into the Pacific Ocean in California right now. So what do we learn from that? What we've learned from BP, what we've learned from Exxon, what we've learned from Kalamazoo, that we don't know how to deal with this. We can't deal with it well. You mentioned all of the layers. It's also in the tidal areas, it's the wash. It goes up and down and up and down on the tidal wash at that most biodynamic area where the water meets the shore. So there's no capacity to clean these up because it's impossible. So this 15% spill recovery is a joke. And we all know it, because you can't clean this up once it's in the environment.
Yeah,
and it doesn't. The precautionary principle isn't at play anymore in any of this, right? So, unfortunately, not in action, though, right?
Yeah, and I think, so the spill, I mean, I actually find it kind of difficult to talk about it. It's heartbreaking. I mean, everything from the tiny benthic organisms that are at the bottom of the food chain, everything that is touched by that oil dies, you know, if not immediately, then ultimately. And I think we haven't really learned anything from past experience, and I kind of wonder when we will start to learn. It is hard to talk about. I think the one thing that gives me a little bit of hope is that there doesn't seem to be the same ability of the media and the oil companies to shut people down in this case. The Gulf of Mexico spill, people were completely shut down. You know, there was really no reporting on what was happening in the Gulf. There wasn't reporting on the marine mammals or any of the birds or anything else that was showing up dead on the beaches. And in this case, people are posting photos so that people are aware of what's happening. And I think the power of the people in this particular case is somewhat hopeful in an otherwise completely disastrous situation.
It is a hard thing for sure to talk about. And for me, sort of a kicker with the California spill is that it's on the west coast of North America, in the same area where several jurisdictions have a state of emergency declared because of droughts, California, Washington. And we have this substance that we take out of the ground, and if it gets away from us before we get it to the last stage that we use it in, it's chaos. And when we get it to the last stage, which is burning, that creates chaos too. So the question has to be, you know, how are we still doing this, right? We just had like our third or fourth solar spill in a row here in Victoria, and we have nothing to show for it but sunburns. And that has to be what's driving the transition. The fact that they're so close to each other, I don't know how to get to a drought area from the oil spill area in California, how far you'd have to ride your bike. But that they're both happening in the same place sort of adds to the heartbreak of it for me.
I just want to flag too, in Seattle, I don't know if any of you would have seen this recently too, there was a huge protest against the proposed Arctic drilling rig that's going up there, which is ridiculous, right? Like, let's be honest, they talk about spill response plans, they have no idea how to clean that up once it hits the ice, right? So, it's ridiculous. So,
there's any kind of technology you want them to take, but they're taking old stuff as old as what was done. Mm-hmm. And somehow they don't think it's that much colder than the Arctic than it was.
And they already lost one last year. They almost slammed into the coast. You know, like I can't imagine what Shell actually figured out differently that they got these approvals in the last 8 months.
Yeah. So that leads. I'm going to comment briefly on your question, Michael, and then I'll introduce the last question, and the responses will double as the closing remarks from the speakers. I think this does expose the point that any increase in the transport of fossil fuels poses a risk that's not worth taking. And that's what the city and the Capital Regional District are going to be telling the NEB. And when you manage to become an elected official, you get a bit of a disproportionate voice and influence. So Mr. Kinder's Canadian lieutenant, the president of Kinder Morgan Canada, is coming to that. We're going to ask him point blank, will you consider withdrawing your application to honor the clearly expressed wishes of dozens of local governments and residents?
And First Nations across the
country. We'll just ask outright to ask them, please withdraw your application and invest this capital in something else and less destructive. The last question is, how do we reduce consumption? And I guess implicit in that is consumption of energy and stuff. In order to, I think, combat climate change in a way that makes the survival of humans and non-human species sustainable in the longer run, and also to eliminate the need for increased tankers, pipelines, and tar sands. So, how do we reduce consumption?
It's about changing the way we evaluate what a good life looks like, I think. And people are coming to this on their own across the board. We all know that what we were sold in the post-war period in terms of suburbia is not actually making anybody happier, healthier, wiser, any of this. And the consumption question also leads into a degrowth question, which is about like, and a localization question. So it's really, we're at such an interesting time because we do have the benefits of technology on our side. We have the benefits of mass communication, the equalization of the internet. Like, there's a lot of stuff, but technology is not going to save us. What's going to save us is an adjustment of our expectations. We have an expectation of levels of luxury that our grandparents never aspired to, you know, and we expect it as a society. It's ridiculous, right? And so it's about recalibrating what our expectations are and what it looks like to have a good life. And it's about not just surviving and this grind and this level of debt that's unsustainable on a day-to-day level. It's about recognizing we live in great abundance and increasing that narrative. Climate change was an issue that, you know, scientists were really freaked out about when they figured out what was going on, and they thought, more facts! We just need to tell them a few more facts, and then they'll change their ways. And that's not the way it works. What that does is shut everyone down. And instead, what we need to be really talking about and talking to our neighbors, and this is something everybody can do. It's not just about recycling and all these things, but every day that you do that, you are moving it incrementally closer to what we all need to be doing. Efficiency is a boring topic, but it's a super easy example of how we can go forward. So just even the efficiency stuff and talking to your neighbors, supporting local things. Like, there's, you know, I'm preaching to the choir here for sure, but this conversation is really important. And degrowth, starting to think about a degrowth economy or a steady state economy, these are things that we need to at least talk about. They're not going to happen overnight, but we need to actually acknowledge that there are a lot of other ways. We don't need this rapacious capitalist system. This isn't the only alternative.
I think it's a shift to a values-based system that recognizes sort of an acceptance of what we have and a recognition of the abundance that we do have. And I think that fundamental to that, to get the change that we desire, it means fighting for the democracy that is actually already ours. And if we are able to do that, then we'll end up with a system that is much more fair and not being controlled by the corporations who have the rapacious attitude towards the planet and all of us.
One of the most powerful examples of the power of looking at our consumption, I heard from a fellow named Andrew Moore, who's the program director for the Solar Initiative for the Tsauk First Nation, just near Souk, to the west of here. And the Tsauk are the most solar-powered community in North America. The largest percentage of their energy comes from solar of any jurisdiction in North America. In rainy old soup, and we've had him in for events. Sierra Club has brought him in, put him on a stage. I think actually this stage. And the most powerful part of what he has to say is when he was brought in to look at how to make Selk a solar community. This is the reserve, not the city or not the town of Souk. He said we have to look at consumption. They did workshops on energy use, on workshops on TV ownership, or how many TVs are on at a time, how many appliances are plugged in, what kind of windows you have on your house, all these different things. And when looked at in conjunction and done at a community level, they were able to drop their community electricity demand by 50%. So that's, you know, suddenly instead of saying we have this much, this high of an electricity, of an energy demand to meet, we're never going to do it with solar, we're never going to do it with wind. Yeah, I sound like an oil executive now. If you can immediately drop that to here, it suddenly becomes twice as feasible. So that's the thing that I really took inspiration from, and looking at creating as much as we need, not as much as we want. That's another that's another big part of it. So if you have a chance to check to learn more about Tsauk, initiative. There's a little piece on it on our climate solutions paper, which literally just came off the presses today at the back there, and we're looking at organizing a field trip, sort of a tour down to the Tselk system later in the summer. They've got solar panel apparatuses sort of in their traditional indigenous art designs, which is, I can't think of anything cooler than that moving forward for the kind of future we need to build.
Awesome.
Yeah, thank you. I'll give a brief reply to that, and then I think we'll adjourn. I know there are some people in this room who question the limits to growth, and I think believe that if there was a substantial enough change to the economic system, we may not have to suggest that people need to make do with less. I'm a little bit more in the camp of the panelists, but I think it's a discussion maybe worth having, a debate on the limits of growth, question mark, and Lee might want to be a panelist, and even raising questions, is nuclear a part of a clean energy future? Maybe Joan and Lee on the same panel, see what gets worked out. But they're all debates worth having. But my view, my comments, as a municipal official, I've been looking a lot at four main systems tied to human need. The housing system, the water system, the food system, and the transportation system, and related to that, the economic system, flowing income to people. I think the more you can provide for those social needs through social ownership and cooperative mechanisms, the more people can get by with less sort of cash income. So if we have a robust and affordable housing system and a high quality public sort of no or low cost water supply system, which fortunately we essentially have for our clean water supply, if food is accessible and nutritious, if transportation is free or close to it in terms of mass transit and walking and cycling, you can make do with a lot less. And then the cultural system ties in as well, because that whole thing, if I can't dance, it's not my revolution. And so education, the arts are all part of, I think, a sustainable and well-functioning cultural system. So I think the key is that, how do these systems work in balance? How do we ensure that one actor or one major institution in a system doesn't dominate or negatively impact the others? And particularly when we look at the economic system, that's where the concentration, I think, of private power and benefits to shareholders and firms like Kinder Morgan can have so many impacts and throw all the other systems that are a part of a sustainable way of life, throws that out of balance. So part of a project that I'm committing to is looking for fairly substantive changes in our economic system and putting more resources into those specific subsystems tied to providing for human need in an ecologically sustainable way. So thanks, everyone. Coming tonight. It's an honor to be here with the panel. I want to thank all the sponsoring groups, the Wilderness Committee, Sierra Club of BC, Raincoast, Turning the Tide, Social Environmental Alliance. You're welcome to and encouraged to join us at Cenote, 768 Yates Street, and there'll be ongoing events. And I wonder if we almost view tonight's event as a beta version of maybe a robust town hall in the fall where we reach out to the non-converted, because this is a great discussion for all of us to have, and get people from Fairfield and Sydney and everywhere in between to really talk in a serious way about what sustainability in the region around the Salish Sea looks like. So thanks, everyone. Mm-hmm. Yeah.